Welcome back, fellow armchair generals. This is Gamer 1745 here. We're going to see if we can take Moscow this episode. That's sort of my goal, but I'm not promising anything. I need to be smart about this. If it takes more than this episode, they're not going to win, but if they take more than this episode, fine, so be it. Uh-oh. Gotta watch that. Stop. We're gonna have all the HQs back in Berlin. Oh, this was one up there. Okay. This is taking it forever. Okay, retreat back, retreat back. Just exhausting ourselves there. Everybody already had the orders. Everybody up to the front. Now. God, you guys need to be way up at the front as well. I'm moving supplies over here, aren't I? Yep. Okay, so... Good, we've got these guys trapped, yay. Take them down. Okay, close air support prototypes have advanced. That's lovely. Okay, we're going to improve our road network. Not going to happen too fast, but hey. Fortunately, we've done a lot of that beforehand. So now that we've got that, let's start shoving troops into Leningrad. Especially up there. We're nearly fully organized. Nope, we may do it pretty soon. We may do Leningrad instead of Moscow this episode. That wouldn't be terrible. Send you down. You down here. Occupation duty. Okay, we are officially at the gate of Moscow. Yes. Anybody not actively moving goes forward. When we're going to attach those to anybody, but okay, keep them going forward. Oh, good. I thought we won this battle, actually. Oh, no, we lost, I guess. Oh, good. Pocket died. All those conscript units. Either they're dead and gone, which is what I hope, or they've shattered and gone to Moscow. Or wherever they're a shattered unit. Since we're right here, they won't have time to properly reform. Okay, let's see. In this battle, we lost... Uprising. Okay. India's going to it. Okay, Legio Verato. Portugal has decided to send a voluntary Legio Verato to support us in our fight against Bolshevism. Quite honestly, I haven't heard of that in historical sense. I'm not saying it didn't happen, just I haven't heard of it, and I'm not saying especially if doing very well, like outside Moscow and close enough a line to us, they wouldn't do that. Okay, new ambassador to Japan, whatever. German-Soviet commercial agreement is over. Well, it should have been over a long time ago, but okay. Ukrainian Liberation Army, supported by General Kestring, who was responsible for the formation of the Eastern Legions, who was sized to 50,000 men in 1942, towards the end reached 80,000. UVV included part as part of the Wehrmacht and was supplied with a lot of German officers. Yes, okay, good. Well, we just gained manpower. The Indian Legion. Been waiting for this to happen for a long time. Okay, more of Burr Commandos, Becker's Martyrs conversions. Great. Soviet railways too wide. As Germans advanced deeper into Russia, it was discovered the Soviet rail network was almost useless. Now, I've read that up 35 years ago, you know. You're getting a hint at my age, of course. So this isn't new to me, but what I have to wonder is, what the hell were the Germans thinking? I mean, if I have the second largest viewing audience is Germany for this channel after the U.S. So there's a lot of Germans there. Presumably they all read German. So obviously, you know, I read stuff in English, so I, you know, it either comes from the American or the British perspective, or books by Manstein, Guderian, that have been translated into English. And Manstein and Guderian, hey, they're generals, so that's, you know, they're great panzer generals, and they know what they're doing there, and so it's not them. What the hell were the Germans thinking this thing? And maybe this isn't true. Maybe this is just what I've sort of been read, you know, read, taught, seen in documentaries, that they discovered the Soviet railway network was almost useless. They should have known that in 1936, because there were lots of Germans traveling in Imperial Russia. And to my understanding, and maybe I'm again wrong, my understanding is that the Soviet railway gauge was the same as the Tsar's railway gauge. And even if that wasn't the case, there were many Germans fighting in the Russian Civil War, some of them in generally broad strokes, because they were Freikorps up here in the Baltic states. There were Germans fighting alongside of some of the white armies down here, maybe small numbers of them, especially down in the southern part, but there were some there that were fighting along there. And there were obviously lots of white Russians that came out of Eastern Europe. and we've talked about Rosenberg and a few others that were Germans with a background of the Germans living in Tsarist Russia. And so they, you know, okay, Rosenberg may not be a railway engineer, but you should be able to know that. I mean, there are enough, a few of them should realize the size difference. You also had Germans going into the Soviet Union for tank trials and aircraft trials in the 20s and into the 30s, doing secret research in the Soviet Union. So they had to know, I mean, if they just thought about it for a second, somebody at the logistics end of the thing thought about it for a second that, oh, Russia's railway gauges are different than ours. Now, I don't know, did they just presume that they were going to be able to capture enough rolling stock that wherever the border is, they just, that's where you would, you know, set up a bit of railway interlocking so that one railway car pulls up next to another one and they, you know, unload from one and load into the other and then roll on? Did they really think that they're going to get enough railway stock to do that? And yes, we've done some events here that prepare the for the invasion. But I just can't imagine the lack of thinking that went in. And even if you just thought it was the Hitlerite, kicking the door, the Soviets are going to collapse, it's all a house of cards. Okay, fine, but then you're going to occupy this territory. You don't think about making preparations, having whatever it is that you need to go in and readjust the railway gauges to the correct size. Sure, some of the switching stations and that kind of stuff may have to really be sort of remanufactured, but a lot of the great amounts of the rail is you just go in and pull up one side and shift the bedding and things and re-stick it down to a better gauge and just have all the material, the manpower, and the manpower trained, you know, like we've talked and had a lot of events here with the RAD or Organization Tote or them in combination, hiring lots of locals or conscripting locals or whatever as they move east to very rapidly adjust the railway gauges as they were going, as well as planning, hey, at some point some Soviet officer is going to blow up a bridge, at some point some Soviet officer is going to blow up a railway line just wherever randomly. So, you know, prepare to fix things as you go along. You know, this is maybe before they thought there was going to be a lot of partisan activity, but have some prep to put the railways in, even if you're just simply having to drive the panzers east to occupy. You know, meaning that there's no, you know, if the house of cards falls in, what are they really, did they really not think that they were going to have to get out to here? Is that like, you know, to occupy it? And that they might need fuel and food and whatever else just to occupy it. And as you're moving east, you need to adjust things that you didn't even do some of the stuff. And sure, you may go, well, yeah, they could use the regular railway to get, yeah, but I don't know. So that's what I've heard forever. So I've heard it so much, I presume it's true. What I just can't get my head around is that nobody thought about that. It's sort of like the winter clothes thing. They had a bunch of winter uniforms, but they were all back in Germany when winter hit. I don't care what you thought the you know, the resistance or the length of the campaign. You were going to have significant, maybe not all the millions of men, but a minimum a third of the Barbarossa troops would just be put into occupation duties, that you didn't plan to get the winter clothing up in the first winter to them. Those weren't, because, you know, that's on the calendar. You know that's going to happen. It's not one of those things that surprises you. How severe the winter is, that may surprise you. Some of the stuff may be a surprise, but that winter's coming shouldn't be a surprise. So that's sort of that. So, okay, the White Rose. Diwasi Rose. This was a group of German students who were, I'm sure they were anti-Nazis, very much so, as you can read about them here, that they started a leaflet and also a, you know, just an anti-war group as well. Started a leaflet campaign. They were basically university students in Munich. And they printed up and distributed a bunch of leaflets and called for active opposition to the dictator Adolf Hitler's regime. The students from the University of Munich comprised the core of the White Rose, and they're listed there. They should not be forgotten. And basically they were imprisoned and killed. You know, that's just what the Nazis do to people who oppose them, even just by printing out leaflets. So we get a little bit of dissent and lose a little bit of national unity. So it shows not just from a few students in Munich putting out some leaflets, but just, I mean, the point, obviously, is to remember the white, these students pictured there as part of the White Rose and honorable Germans actively standing up to resist the Nazis. In this, not shooting people, obviously, but and publicly going out and saying that this is wrong, that they shouldn't be doing this. So these were the few brave souls, but there had to be others that just weren't as brave to go out and distribute leaflets, but did do minor things to disrupt the Nazi regime. So we get a little bit of dissent. Lose a little bit of national unity. Kampfgruppe Keitel. Okay. Yep. Take that. Petrol rationing. Now. Because we're doing so bad on the petrol there. Gain 2 in descent. Lose 1 in descent. Nope, we're not going to take it. U-boat. Pen in St. Nazarene constructed. That's down here. And these U-boat pens, they were... some of them, at least, I know, maybe some of the ones up in Lorient, they were not just a, like you're seeing here, a bomb-proof port to come in and resupply and go back out. They were also assembly, construction locations for the submarines that were under these huge things. So they were actually being put together. I think a lot of the components... the manufactured components were being shipped in and they were being, you know, assembled, but there's a fair amount of construction, so we lose some supplies, a bunch of them. Yeah, we'll do that. Okay, so we'll get that. I'm not even going to try to pronounce all of this, but the German police, as you can see, not the German army. And middle. Deploy. 17th Flak Division. Yeah, okay, we can lose an anti-aircraft gun in Leipzig. Form NSKK transport group Speer. Well, this I believe is a event from GGA, so it's sort of duplicating what we are, at least an event, have with not that it's wrong, but it's just we already have some events from TRE with this. Now this one, I guess, which we gain some manpower as opposed to where I've given mostly just those few spear group transport units you can attach to other units. So, okay. Tech manpower. That's nice. railway police protection. Yes, the Reichsbahn, the railway police, Reichsbahn did have a police force for itself, and it did operate into occupied territories, effectively. As you see, that is sort of an interesting picture. It's definitely a Reichsbahn uniform. I recognize that. He is carrying an MP18. That's a machine pistol 1918, basically. And what is curious to me as an arms collector is that this is World War II, where some, or maybe slightly before, I'm not exactly sure on the date of the photo, because that's not a comp, he's just shooting that for the camera somewhere. But at least I presume so. You don't get in front of a gun like that to take a photograph of it in combat. But it has the snail drum magazine on it. Most, but maybe not as many as I'm thinking, were converted, the MP18s were converted to carry a stick magazine. This is the Luger snail drum magazine. It comes out there with a single position feed like the Luger machine gun or the pistol. And this is a really finicky drum magazine that's hard to reload. Like I say, it's finicky that it, a little bit of dust or dirt gets in there, can really mess that up. Where the stick magazine double column was developed, and a lot of them were produced as an MP28. I'm not exactly sure if that's the first year of introduction or just put it, added a 2 to it or something like that. But a lot of the early MP18s were otherwise just the same, but converted to use the more functional and cheaper to manufacture. This thing is also cumbersome. To have a couple extra magazines carrying on you is very difficult. Though it would take a Luger pistol magazine you could stick in there for its 7 rounds if you wanted to. So yes, we will take that. Supply throughput improved a little bit. Good. Development of a new battle tank. Okay, the Panther was a German medium tank. I'm sure you all know about this. Developed very much to deal with the T-34. So metal supplies, metal, we can obviously, whatever. Supplies were already negative, so we'll take that. It isn't my fault that it's negative so much as you can see here. 4,000 being returned to stockpile. We're using up a bunch. So, yes, we'll take the improved tank. Okay, we have captured Soviet equipment. Those are obviously Americans looking at captured German equipment. So, yes, they will be useful. We don't need the supplies or the raw materials, really. So, another similar event. Another one. The reason we're having so many of these things happen, I think, is a year-date situation, 1942, and that I'm making several episodes all at once without stopping, and so not many of these episodes have just been a few days stop and whatever, so they've not been firing like they should be. The reason that this is red now is, as you can look up there, is we have more base IC than we have available, because we have all of those, and you can see them down there, railway things from 1% to negative, to a couple of them are negative 10 or 15%. So that has got us below even our base IC levels. So that's why we're going red there. Those effects will come off. Soon, hopefully. Or as time goes by, at least. Okay, let's see now. Portuguese. Okay, so this is a militia unit with some artillery. Okay. They're not very dedicated soldiers, I guess. The Indian Legion, yes. This is good. This is obviously too large. There weren't that many Indian troops. If we were talking a large Indian unit, it would be for Japan. They had a fairly large stuff. Now, often I send this out to India just sort of because it's the Indian Legion, send it to India. It has good occupation capabilities to deal with all uprisings in India. Their colonial troops, so yeah, we'll send them down there. So that's a good unit boost. Okay. Beckers. Well, we're going to leave these guys here. Because I don't know what to do with them at the moment. They really should be attached to some other units. Okay, comp group and title. Kaito. Or Nittle, Kittle, Nittle. I don't know. Well, okay. There we go. We will send one out here to add to that. Okay, police. I think it's better. I'm not gonna have anybody in charge of this. No leader. Let's have them a little bit more spread out. Now let's take a look at. Okay. Send him down there. So far, at least mostly, we're not talking too much for partisan disruption of supplies. I don't even think it's worth it to put a bad general in charge here, because there will be some events that spring up a bunch of partisans. I'm sure that will happen. I don't know when. Don't know how inconvenient it's going to be, but it's going to happen. Mostly, even these police units can deal with those. So, and there's so little fighting that you're not going to get improvement on it. Okay. Black division. Okay, well. It shouldn't be a garrison detachment. That, I just think, is too slow. I turned some of the earlier ones into light infantry. That may be good, or just regular infantry. Because they did have a fair amount of transport for all of their anti-aircraft. Okay. These guys, we're just going to leave here to recruit up. Even there. Light armor, that's nice. That's good. Okay, so those are all good to have. We also had a bunch of breakout from here in India of some partisans. Okay. Bummer. Well, he's trapped up there, so he's gonna find his way back. Okay, now back to the fighting. Oh, killed the partisan there. No. No, we're pounding on him. Finally, the pocket dies. The last of them is dead. Just occupation, so we'll get these guys going somewhere. Just sort of a remainder unit that should have gone bye-bye that didn't. We got an event. Now, about this guy here, let's see if he can find some points to there. He's going to put some points to there. Well, this is down here, too. Been fighting a few of these remainder British units here that shouldn't be here, but are here. Oh, wow! Barry is dead. We got killed one of their leader units. Yay! That, I think, is going to disrupt their national unity. Well, sinking of the... What's it? Pietro di Yama. Pietro di Yano? Two L's in Spanish. At least I was taught is a Y sound. SS Pietro di Yano. Oil tanker sunk. So, pissed off the Mexicans. The Calmiac Voluntary Cavalry Corps. Bunch of the Cossacks joined the Germans. A bunch stayed loyal to the Soviets as well. I don't know why they stayed loyal to the Soviets, whether it was just their headmasters thought it was the Soviets were going to win, or the Soviets were the Russians and they had long been loyal to the Russians, or other reasons, or maybe possibly because some of the different Cossack types didn't like each other. Maybe some went one side, others went another. Okay, Freikorps Denmark. This was a volunteer corps. I think I mentioned this. That started out with a bunch of Danish army troops. It became more and more, or that were sort of once they got that joined to fight Bolshevism, but then once they sort of got a bit east in their training camp, wherever, were given SS uniforms. So, and it became more and more of an SS outfit as time went on. Himmler demands a panzer force. Okay. The future of the Soviet Union. Okay, well, let's see. We're doing fairly well for manpower. Starting experience. I don't know that we need that. We got lots of money. New battle commander. It's new battle commander. Land air organization. I don't know that we have an organization problem, so we'll go with 100 manpower. Okay, let's see. I think we're going to go no need for new viceroys as opposed to the Reich commissars. I think that's what I want to do. The Reich commissars, if I really haven't had that event much, is a sets up a puppet states. I just don't like the puppet states mechanism. And this is obviously the third of the month, where before the first, Smolensk take another one of the events from TRE. Again, found a photo album here. A German from someone's maps, another hard fight, and we've taken Smolensk. The railway, this is a photo of the railway station. We'll tour the city. Okay, I guess the tour of this. I know I've improved some of this, but this version hasn't. Okay. This is Minsk taken. You see a picture of Minsk, another one. And inside of a House of Government. Office House. Okay, I'm pretty sure that those events were improved in the later version of TRE after I got some feedback. Okay, Germansk SS Norge, German SS Norway or whatever, however you want, Norge, Norway, whatever. As we've talked about in some of the earlier episodes some time ago, the SS was expanding into Norway. They very much wanted to bring Norway into the Greater Reich. And I'm not exactly sure why, because if you may happen to notice, and I know a lot of you aren't uniform buffs, they're all wearing black uniforms. I'm not exactly sure why this is, because by this time, the SS themselves had long since stopped wearing black uniforms. They had all moved over to gray uniforms, and it's very, very rare and that anybody's wearing a black uniform this late, but for some reason the Norwegian SS, and I also believe that the Danish and a few of the other foreign SSs adopted black. Whether that was a case of, hey, there's a bunch of old remainder SS uniforms, let's ship them up there and they wear them, or whether this was a other sort of cultural or political reason they decided to go with black, but they did. And this will expand the SS in Norway, new industrial zone, new Panzer Corps, great, Schwerdora, no, I'm not going to build that, Kampfgruppe Knering, great, Krim, so the Crimea. Police units there to control the new lands. Deploy the 15th Flak Division. Dortmund, yeah. See. What's one of these in here? Okay, game mechanics is that if, and the AI determines that there's three or more flak guns in a province, it stops bombing. However effective or ineffective the flak guns are, there they stop. So we're just losing a little manpower and a little supplies to get a flak division that's deployable, so that's a good thing. Collapse of the Greek monetary system! As the collapse of the Greek monetary system was imminent, the Germans were alarmed that such a possibility would render worthless the flow of the drachma to their troops. In order to deal with the situation, Hermann Heybacher was appointed Reich Special Commissioner in Greece. Neubacher. Objective was to sustain Axis operations in Greece without destroying the Greek economy. When the war broke out, Neubacher took the war. Ah, how much does history repeat itself? We lose money until... Okay, so this is more than maybe just Greece, but notice 75% of money until 19... probably maybe an event that will take this off, at least I hope so, but so that really gonna hurt us on our money there. Hopefully it's just a short-term event with a replacement thing, otherwise it's gonna hurt us long-term for a lot. Okay, now let's attach you to it. Yeah, we'll put gender these guys here. Keep winning these battles here, and they're just retreating. Oh well. Whatever. But just once they come, Vichy gets into the war, they'll start to react more to it there. We're gonna have to fight them. Oh, good. I had this guy attack north just to drive out all of these guys. Hopefully that, or at least help to, and hopefully the Italians will get in and take over that. No, we're taking out that. Well, we'll rescue them with the panzers. Well, I don't think we're going to get to taking Moscow this turn, or this episode. He took a cuff. Go for it. Cross that river. Okay, thanks for viewing, thanks for liking the videos, do appreciate that, and please post comments, do want to hear your thoughts.